Hello, everybody. Scott Roberts here with Dr. Rosaly Lopes. Rosaly is a planetary geologist. She's a volcanologist. She is an author, a JPL scientist, and she has a passion for volcanoes, obviously. So if you've read any of her books or seen her in any of her lectures, Rosaly is someone that is driven and is one of the most amazing women in science today. Rosaly, thank you for joining us today, and it's great to see you.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. Thank you for the very flattering introduction.
I don't think I did it well enough, you know, because there's really, you are one of the most inspirational people on the planet, I believe. And, you know, the more I read about what you've done and what you're doing and, you know, all the responsibilities that you have, I think that you must be an inspiration to many, many thousands or maybe millions of people around the world. So it's great. It's great. Yeah. Now, we had earlier started to share your screen. You're going to have to do it again to bring up any slides or presentation.
All right. Okay. Start sharing and let's go to slideshow.
Okay.
And what would you like to ask me, first of all?
First off, I mean, let's just kind of go, before we even get into your slides here, let's talk about your, maybe this is kind of an introduction, and I hope to have you on another show sometime so that we can dive into something more particular. But, you know, you are, I read that you were born in Brazil, and were you born in Ipanema near?
Well, I'm not sure if the hospital was in Ipanema, but you know, but that's kind of a picture of Ipanema Beach there at the bottom, and pictures of me growing up. I certainly grew up in Ipanema, so you know, people sometimes joke with me about the song, you know. I'm one of the many girls from Ipanema.
Yes, you are. Well, it's, I've been there. It's a beautiful place, and it is the one thing I can say about Brazil. My first impression is just how warm and friendly people from Brazil are. And the other thing I will say too is that I just felt that people in Brazil are overall take care of their health. They seem to be really interested in science and space exploration.
That's all true. I am often surprised how particularly young people in Brazil seem to be more interested in science and space exploration than you know, the kids here.
Yes, right. But it's great to have you on. And so let's talk a little bit. I guess what I would really want to know, I mean, you're growing up. Did you have like some very early impressions about the natural world or science that led you to be who you are today?
Yes, I grew up following the Apollo program. And I was really, really interested in the Apollo program. You know, I also liked science fiction shows on TV and, you know, anything to do with space. I was lucky that I had a source of inspiration, you know, that at the time of the Apollo program, you know, you only saw men. In the control room, and all the astronauts except for one Russian were all men. And I wanted to be an astronaut, but quite early on, I realized that being female Brazilian and having terrible eyesight was not really going to cut it. So I decided to become a scientist, and I really wanted to work for NASA. And I didn't let the fact that, all these difficulties in the way, being Brazilian, female, all that, I didn't let that get in the way. And luckily, I started learning English at quite an early age. But one day, during the time of Apollo 13, I saw a picture in the newspaper, and I'll show you in this slide. This is France's always called Poppy Northcutt.
Right, I wanted to ask you about Poppy.
Yeah, and she's really extraordinary. And this is her during Apollo 13 at the Johnson Space Center. And a Brazilian newspaper had this picture. I very, very distinctively remember this picture, and talked about her. And they didn't talk about so much about the fact that she had a degree in mathematics and she was really bright, but they talked about the fact that she was the only woman working in mission control, and of
Wow.
course she was young and pretty and blonde,
I
and
see.
they and they just ran with that. But to me, she became this amazing source of inspiration.
Sure. Yeah, well, she had to be brilliant to work in that room anyways. And certainly in those days, I can imagine she had difficulties in that all male, mostly male environment. So
I think that she didn't pay so much attention to that. We actually met for the first time last year. In fact, we talked for the first time last year. I had wanted to meet her because she was such an inspiration to me. And when I came to the US, I tried to find out about her, and I found out that she had left the space program. And she had become an attorney, and she had become a criminal defense attorney,
Wow.
which is very, very different.
Very
And
different. Yeah.
yeah, and well, but last year, I was talking to someone in the Brazilian consulate in Houston, and I just thought about it. I thought, could you do me a favor and try to locate this lady? And she said, oh, sure. And not only she did that, she actually called Poppy at her office and told her about me. So we spoke for the first time, and an amazing coincidence within a couple of days of when Apollo 13 returned to Earth, that anniversary. So it was nearly, perhaps exactly, 49 years after I had seen her in the paper. And last year, I had the pleasure of welcoming her to JPL.
Oh, my
And
goodness. Wonderful.
yeah, so and and she was really pleased that she had inspired me. She said she had received letters from little girls from all over the world.
I can imagine.
And talking to her, she said that she was respected in her team, so she didn't really have problems with the people she worked with. And that was good to hear because, again, I never really focused on the difficulties. I always decided that I was going to do my work and the best work I could because people are largely judged by their work, professionally. So you just have to do the best you can.
Sure, that's right. That's right. I find also, certainly with a group of intelligent people that they focus on the task at hand, and and of course you're in a room where you're, all filled with explorers, people that are trying to do the science, trying to collect the data, trying to reach their goals, and so I'm glad to hear that it wasn't a very tough time for her, so but that doesn't mean that sometimes in the science world that women have not had their challenges, so I'm sure that you hear of it. But let's get on with you come to the United States. You're a young teen at this time, or how old are you when you first come in?
Well, I was in my 20s.
Okay.
I came here as a postdoc, so I did actually my degree and PhD in England. I realized pretty quickly that Brazil didn't really have at the time the professional environment that I wanted. It's a developing country, and there wasn't really a space program, and things are very different now, and there is a lot of great research in Brazil. But at the time, I wanted to go abroad, so I went to University College London, and part of the University of London, and I did a degree and a PhD there, and then I worked for 3 years at the Greenwich Observatory, actually some of that while I was finishing my PhD. So you know where the meridian is, the prime meridian? I used to cross that several times a day.
There's like a
And
yellow line that comes up to it, right? I mean, isn't there?
that's right. Yes.
Wow.
And
Okay.
I had probably the most beautiful office I'm ever going to have in my life,
Sure.
in a building from 1675. But I wasn't doing quite what I wanted to do because I really had that dream of working for NASA, being part of the space program. So I had a chance to come to JPL as a postdoc, and it was a contract for 2 years. But I took a risk and I left my permanent job in England and and my friends, everything, and came to the US, and luckily worked out.
Yeah, it says also, I'm reading, and it says that you performed hazard mapping at the Vesuvius Observatory in Naples as a visiting researcher. What is hazard mapping?
Well, what I was doing was looking at the path of lava flows historically, and finding out which areas were more at risk from lava flows. You look at the frequency of eruptions on in that area, and I studied during my PhD the let's say the physics of lava flows and how they flow and how they widen, what length they reach, and that kind of thing. So I spent 6 months in Naples, Italy, before coming to JPL. I had a short postdoc there. So that was interesting too.
So, is this the start of where your passion for volcanoes is? This the is this does it start before then? Is it something you were just always fascinated in, or?
Well, no, I always had a sense of adventure, but Brazil has no active volcanoes. So I was interested in geology, very interested actually in gemstones. I know it's very female, but
I
I
like them.
hadn't really thought about volcanoes. But during my undergraduate days, I took a class in planetary geology, and I really enjoyed the class. The professor was really good. And about maybe a month into the course, the professor didn't show up, and a postdoc came to give the class, and he said, "Oh, Mount Etna in Sicily erupted, and the professor had to go because he's a volcanologist." And I thought, "Oh, that sounds exciting."
Sure.
And by then, I was kind of tired of freezing in the, our university's astronomical observatory,
Right.
and I thought going exploring volcanoes sounds much more what I would like for a PhD. So I ended up doing a PhD with him.
I see. So when I think of this hazard mapping work that you did, there's a quote. There's one quote from you that you can find on the internet, and it talks about, I'll paraphrase, but it's basically, that you're surprised at how often people that you're perhaps working with are come totally unprepared, okay, for the situation of being around a volcano. I would imagine that you're in an ultra dangerous place. I've been in Volcanoes National Park a couple of times. Your skin is stinging from the sulfur in the air, a sulfuric acid maybe. Your lungs are stinging from it. It smells horrible. But at the same time, you become drawn to seeing glowing lava and seeing new earth erupt from the ground. So, you know, I imagine people become, you know, very addicted to this.
Actually, I like that volcano smell because it makes me realize I'm close to a live volcano, and I love that. Mm-hmm. I came to do a PhD to study volcanoes on other planets, specifically Mars. But my advisor told me you can't understand volcanoes on Earth unless you understand them. You can't understand volcanoes on other planets unless you understand them on Earth. Mm-hmm. So after a few months of the PhD, or close to a year, it was summer field season, and he took me with the rest of the group to Mount Etna, and Mount Etna erupted, had amazing strombolian, what we call strombolian activity, looked like fireworks. I was totally hooked. Yeah. So I've been hooked on active volcanoes ever since. And I was very well trained. I was trained at, on field work on active volcanoes. So I knew what was dangerous, what wasn't. Mostly I have encountered tourists going to see the lava who, you know, really have no idea what they're doing and can get into quite dangerous situations. And this is why I wrote a book called The Volcano Adventure Guide. It's all about volcanoes on Earth. It was, actually the first book I wrote. Mm-hmm. And it's because, you know, people ask me often, how do I visit live volcanoes? How do I visit them safely? And there are many different types of volcanoes. There are different types of eruptions. And, you really have to know what is safe and what isn't.
Right. Yeah, as a tourist, I've been to, Volcanoes National Park, and I saw people walking over. We came in kind of late in the afternoon, and you could see, glowing lava in the fissures, and people are walking right over it. And it just makes your heart stop, because you know that perhaps they're only walking on just like a thin piece of glass or something, right?
Yes. In Hawaii, we have something called Shelley lava. That means it has a thin shell.
Yeah.
And that can be very dangerous because there is still lava flowing underneath. And if you break through that shell, you could be in a lot of trouble.
Yes.
So there are certain ways you can recognize shelly lava and certain places where it's more dangerous to walk. If you go to my screen again, I'm sharing here some slides of Earth's volcanoes. The vertical picture, it's me on the island of Ambrin in Vanuatu. Vanuatu is in the South Pacific, and that is a lava lake. It's a very, very powerfully churning lava lakes, and it's absolutely wonderful to see. And then on the top right, as you look at the screen, on another island in the Vanuatu group, this is Tana Island, and that's strombolian activity. So that is what looks like fireworks. Now, these types of activity you can actually observe quite safely if you know what you're doing. Is the explosive activity that's dangerous. You know, and just underneath is a picture with two colleagues of mine, Janie Radebo and Ralph Lorenz, and we have been on many volcano adventures together. Janie is also a geologist and volcanologist, and Ralph is more, well, he does everything. He's actually an engineer by training, but a planetary scientist by PhD and profession, and he'll often take, various instruments that are very useful, for us to work with. And this is not a lava lake, but is a volcanic landscape in Ethiopia. We went on this great adventure in Ethiopia to see another lava lake.
Oh my God.
And it was fantastic, very remote
Colors and
place.
everything are so amazing as well. It's that Strombolian fireworks, it looks like you're quite close to it. How far away were you in that photo?
Well, I was right on the edge of the crater, but what we call bombs, they are the fragments of lava that come up and then fall down. They were landing inside the crater, so we were quite safe, except that occasionally there is a stronger explosion, and fragments can come out the crater. And that happened, in fact, right after this picture was taken, there was a stronger explosion, so strong that I felt the shock wave on my back, and I immediately jumped up, looked at it, and I had told my friends who were not volcanologists what to do is you look up and you see if a bomb is coming towards you, and if it is, you move sideways, but don't run blindly, don't try to outrun it or anything. And in fact, a big bomb did come outside, but landed about 100 yards away from us. It was, maybe like, 3 or 4 feet across, and it landed with a splat. And it was very useful because even though Vanuatu is in the tropics, it had been raining a bit, and it was quite a cool night. So we used the bomb as a kind of campfire. It was quite warm around
Right. My God.
it.
And your heart's not like pounding through your chest or anything. I mean, I would think you would be I know it would mine, so that would be I've had some other friends that worked around volcanoes, like Stephen O'Meara is one of them, and who you probably know, and some others. One person told me about being, I think it was in Costa Rica, and there was an explosion that happened, and a piece just went like right over his head, so he just barely missed it, so it is a dangerous occupation, I think. And I did talk to a park ranger at Volcanos National Park, and he said they lose tourists every year. So I imagine your book, if they read it, has saved lives. So I'm glad you wrote that, so but
I
go ahead.
like to think so. Although some people die, not specifically because of the volcano, but they are in a very deserted area with no water. They may get heat stroke, dehydration. There are other factors that can be very dangerous, independent of the volcano.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, if you're going to go visit a volcano, buy Rosalie's book and follow all the rules. So it's important. We're starting to get some questions about volcanoes on other planets here with our group. We've got people watching from around the country, and it will probably be watched around the world. Let's talk a little bit about you getting your PhD and how you start to the beginnings of you studying volcanoes on other planets.
I started studying volcanoes on Mars, and particularly Olympus Mons on Mars. Also studied volcanoes like in Hawaii, But you know, really, Mount Etna and Hawaii were the only two volcanoes I studied during my PhD. And I was studying volcanoes on Mars at that time with Viking data because spacecraft hadn't gone back to Mars. You know, I have some pictures here if you want to look at my screen. That's you know, during my undergraduate and graduate days, University College London with that Greek facade. Top picture, I mean, Hawaii, looking at some of the formations there in the cooled lava. Then in my office during my PhD and using the 2018 refractor at Greenwich.
Wow.
So it was a very varied part of my life. But you know, I went to Mount Etna many times, and to you know, Hawaii a couple of times during those days before I came to the US.
Very interesting. And so then you get a job at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. That seems to be right after your time in Italy, is that right?
Well, I came as a postdoc, spent 2 years there, and I had the very good fortune of just before, a few months before I went to JPL, I went to a Mars conference, and by chance, I sat in the audience next to a young woman about my age, and I gave my talk, and she really liked my talk, and you know, started chatting. And it turned out she was originally from Argentina, and I was originally from Brazil.
Wow.
And now her, we became friends. Her name is Adriana Ocampo, and she has worked for many years now at NASA headquarters, but she used to work at JPL. And she was working on the Galileo mission. The Galileo mission went to Jupiter. So she introduced me to the team. And the principal investigator of the instrument she was working with, which was the near-infrared mapping spectrometer, said, "We need someone to help us plan the observations of Io, that's Jupiter's volcanic moon. I'm sharing it now on the
Right.
screen."
See it.
Yeah, and you know, and I said, "Well, I have never studied Io before, but you know, I'm really interested." And I also said, "I have never done any work with infrared spectroscopy." And he said, "Oh, you learn." And you know, they had great confidence in me, and I worked very hard. And in fact, I then became known as an expert on Io.
Yes.
I discovered 71 volcanoes, active volcanoes on Io that you know, no one knew existed. And by very strange turn of fate, I ended up being mentioned in the 2006 Guinness Book of World Records
That's right. That's right.
as the discoverer of the most active volcanoes anywhere.
Right.
But,
I remember hearing the news about discoveries of volcanoes on this moon, and I just thought, wow, it just seemed something kind of amazing to me because this is a process that is happening on another world that has happened here on this world. So I started to think about the formation of solar systems in the respect that similar processes can happen throughout a planetary system, you've discovered all kinds of different volcanoes.
Yes, actually, you know, another one of my papers and my research is to you know, identify lava lakes on Io, and a lot of the volcanoes are actually have lava lakes. Lava lakes are rare enough. We only have about half a dozen of them, usually active, but on Io they seem to be very common. The Io is the only other place in the solar system where we have molten magma volcanism that is volcanism that is molten rock, like the Earth. But we have other type of volcanism called cryovolcanism on other moons. But Io, one of the big questions about Io is what is the composition of the lava? We know is probably basalt, but we detected some suspiciously high temperatures, and mostly using the infrared mapping spectrometer, but also with the camera. And they may be what we call ultramafic, which is a type of very primitive lava on Earth, rich in magnesium. So these lavas erupted on Earth mostly billions of years ago. So in a way, by looking at volcanism on Io, we may be looking at the early Earth.
Wow, very interesting. Why is it because of the gravitational tides or whatever the tugging on Io that gives it so many volcanoes?
Yes, Io is in a peculiar orbit around Jupiter, synchronized with the moons further out. Io is the closest of the Galilean satellites. Those were discovered by Galileo. In fact, in a coincidence, Galileo discovered these moons of Jupiter on January 7th, but it wasn't until January 8th when he saw the movement that he realized that Io was a moon, not a star. And that's actually my birthday, so I'm proud of
Some
that.
faith there. That's awesome.
Yeah,
Awesome.
but Io is in a kind of tug of war between Jupiter's which has a really large gravitational pull, and the other moons that have less of a gravitational pull because they're much smaller, but they're closer to Io. So Io has a tidal bulge that wants to face Jupiter but gets distorted because of the other moons, and so it's constantly kind of like being pushed and pulled. And that keeps the interior molten, and that's why it's still active. Io is about the same size as the moon, the Earth's moon, so it should have cooled a long time ago, and it would have cooled if it wasn't in this particular orbit.
Wow. Okay. All right. So maybe volcanism is part of a, do you think it's part of a normal evolutionary process in a moon or a planet?
Oh yes, absolutely, because volcanism is how planets and moons cool, solid bodies cool. So yes, it's a normal process, and since those days of Voyager in 1979, I was still a student, but when volcanism on Io was discovered, but we have learned that tidal forces actually are really important to keep interiors, molten, and they're probably really important on exoplanets as well.
So I just want to go back just a little bit to some of these discoveries that you've made. You're part of the team. Obviously, you're a quick study, and you are keeping up with everyone, and maybe surpassing some people in the team. I don't know, but to make a discovery, what was that like? I mean, to sit there and see something for the very, very first time that nobody has seen. What is that like?
It was really exciting. I mean, I wouldn't say that discovering these active volcanoes was, academically, any kind of best work or groundbreaking work. But it was certainly a lot of fun. I planned all the observations. Worked on them as they came back, to analyze them. And you can see here an image that IO in the visible and then IO in the infrared, and you can see everything that is red, or white is, it's really hot, or yellow. Those are just like brightness at around 5 microns. And you can even see the terminator, the part that's more blue, that's where its IO is dark. So we had to do a lot of things like to correct the accuracy, the pointing, and then I would identify the actual volcanoes. And before we got to Io, a colleague of mine asked me, "Do you think you're going to find any new active volcanoes?" Because with Voyager, we knew of about a dozen, And I said, "If we're very lucky," but in fact, by the end I had found 71, and then colleagues started joking with me, people in my team, joking, "Oh, it's like butterfly collecting, and you found another active volcano," and "you should be in the Guinness Book of World Records," we just laughed at that. Until a young man from England came to work with me. That was after the end of the Galileo mission, just after. And he heard this and he said, "I have a friend who works for the Guinness Book of World Records. He actually had started to do a PhD on Io, but, he had given up and gotten this job." So he contacted his friend who did all the investigations and got my research papers and all that. And that's how I ended up there.
We have some questions from people watching here. So I'll go ahead and ask them. The first question was from Dan Janicek, and he wants to know, does Mars have any active volcanic activity?
No, not that we know off. There could still be some degassing, possibly, but there is no volcanic activity on Mars anymore.
I see. And then we've got Anshul Puri. Thank you for this great presentation, Dr. Lopez and Scott. One question. Read in the news recently that sunspots have disappeared and that we may see a deep solar minimum. This may cause global temperature drops as well as increased seismic and volcanic activity. Fascinating stuff. Curious about the connection between solar minimums and volcanic seismic activity on Earth and maybe the other planets?
This is something I have never heard of. People have proposed that there could be increased earthquake or volcanic activity, mostly earthquake activity, depending on the alignment, like if the moon and the sun align, together because, of tidal effects.
Sure.
But I have never, ever heard of any
volcanoes erupting because of that. Yes. Jerry Hubble's watching. He wants to know, do the tectonic plates and movement affect how volcanoes are formed?
Oh, absolutely. But it is interesting that the Earth is the only place where we see plate tectonics. And that's something very interesting. Because, probably, or, this is not something I worked on, but you actually need to be in a kind of Goldilocks zone where the size of the crust, the thickness of the crust relative to the size of the planet is just right. Because if the crust is too thick, like we think on Mars, the plates just can't break apart. The crust can't break apart. If the crust is too thin, perhaps the ice crust on Europa, then it would just like crack and float around, but you won't really have movement of plates.
Right.
So the Earth is very unique place in the solar system in this respect, but absolutely the location of volcanoes, whether they are in spreading zones or subduction zones, that changes the composition of the lava, and it affects how explosive the volcanoes will be. The more silica in the lava, the more viscous the lava is, the more it's likely to explode.
I see.
I see.
Tracy Prell asks, what are the significant variations between volcanoes or types of volcanoes on Earth and ones found elsewhere in our solar system?
Well, the Earth, for a start, has this effect of plate tectonics, the Earth has some eruptions that some explosions that are very dependent on water getting into the system. You don't have that on other planets. A lot of volcanoes on other planets are significantly bigger than on the Earth. For example, on Io, we don't have mountains that are volcanoes, but we have huge calderas, like Lopes is about 200 kilometers across. And in fact, I have this great picture of a caldera called Tupan on Io, it's one of the most colorful pictures. In fact, all these yellow and reds, sulfur and sulfur dioxide deposits, and the black is lava, and here you actually can see what appears to be some green flows is some sulfur that we think has melted down from the caldera walls, and if you look at this central island in the here in the middle. You can almost go around it. Someone might think you went around it with a pen, to map it. And that's one of the reasons we know there is a lava lake is because the areas that are dark are hot. And what happens on a lava lake often is that the crust cools and forms like a scum on a pond, but then it's still sloshing underneath. So as that cold crust hits the sides of the caldera, it breaks up. So you see the hotter material there. And we saw that in quite a few volcanoes on Io with the thermal instrument as well. We know that those areas are hot. Io has many more lava lakes than the Earth does. It doesn't have mountains. The activity is mostly what we call effusive, and the explosions are different. On Earth, we have what we call the volatile in the magma is water. On Io is sulfur. So each place has its differences.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you look at the moon, the large dark areas were floods of lava billions of years ago. On Earth, that happened a long time in the past, but we don't see them anymore.
Right. This particular caldera, how big is that?
It's about 70 kilometers across on its longest dimension.
Wow, this is very, very high resolution. It's very, it's beautiful.
It's one of my favorite images.
Yeah.
And this volcano is called Tupan. In fact, I suggested the name because the names of the volcanoes on Io, the convention is that they are gods or mythological characters associated with fire or thunder, and Tupan is the native Brazilian god of thunder.
Beautiful. Let's move on. Let's you went from the Galileo mission to Cassini. Was that your next
Yeah, it was my next adventure. Cassini was a really international mission. You know, here I show a picture of the spacecraft with a bunch of flags from various countries. It was a joint mission between NASA, the European Space Agency, and the Italian Space Agency. And on Cassini, I actually worked with the radar instrument, which was built by the Italians. What we wanted to do was to study the geology of the moon Titan. And Titan has a very dense atmosphere. The best instrument to use to see the geology is if I thought I had a picture of Titan, but maybe not. The best instrument to see the geology is actually the radar.
I
So we
saw
arrived.
on the news, NASA news, in November of 2019 that you guys had completed this map. So for those of you who have not seen this, you should search the JPL website for this. It's a fascinating account.
Yeah, Titan global map actually got all over the place. You know, that was fun. Yes, I led that effort. But we arrived on Saturn in 2004, and Cassini was a beautiful mission. It had very few problems. It was a remarkable piece of engineering. And here is a beautiful image of Saturn arrival. We had scientists working in various groups, you know, some studying Saturn, some studying the rings, some studying the what we call the icy moons, some studying Titan, and some the magnetosphere and the environment around Saturn. So we were a lot of scientists, a big international group. It was a lot of fun.
And there were volcanoes on Titan as well, correct?
Unfortunately, I don't think I have a picture of one, but there are we found active cryovolcanism on Enceladus, and here is a picture of Enceladus. It's a small moon, and here again is tidal forces at work. You can see down near the South Pole. These blue stripes, they got nicknamed tiger stripes. And one of the most exciting discoveries of Cassini was that we actually had vapor, is actually water vapor mostly, coming from an ocean of liquid water that is under that ice crust. So this is what we call cryovolcanism, because in those icy moons, the magma is not molten rock like on the Earth or Io. The magma is actually water, mixed with a few other things like, ammonia, methane, and so on.
Beautiful.
That was very exciting. And, if I can try to find another image, well, here is a just a color, superposed. You can think of these almost as geysers, except that in volcanology, geyser has a very specific meaning. So I prefer to call them jets or plumes. I mean, they are mostly water, so they are almost like geysers. It also opens up the possibility that if that ocean has life, and we think that oceans underneath the crust of Europa or Enceladus are places where life could have evolved, on Enceladus this material is spewing up, so there is a possibility that you could analyze it with a flyby, which would be certainly easier than actually penetrating an ice crust.
So you just fly it through one of these plumes, I guess, and collect the sample. Is that?
And analyze the sample on board. There are some proposals to NASA that have been made. They haven't been selected so far, but people are very interested and missions to Enceladus to try to find sign what we call biosignatures.
Sure.
And so Enceladus is a very exciting place. And I just want to show here, I worked with an artist. We, in fact, have written three books together, Michael Carroll. And one of the books is about Antarctica. We actually went to Erebus, the only active volcano in Antarctica. And this was on a program called the Artists and Writers Program of the National Science Foundation. So I was the scientist, he was the artist, and we were looking for landscapes that could have similar, similar forms to landscapes we might have in the solar system. So there are some ice towers on Erebus, and he imagined some ice towers on Enceladus. It was a fantastic trip. Being in Antarctica is a bit like, I suppose, feeling like you are in a Mars base in the future or a, lunar base. The environment outside is trying to kill you, so
right.
There are precautions.
Yes, but that's an amazing illustration. I need to mention that when I was promoting this talk today, I had asked Carlos Hernandez, who's a space artist, to put together some images, some illustrations he's done. And so next time when you're looking at your announcement, you'll see the landscape that he did, which is kind of cool.
Great.
I know
great.
you love art, volcanic art. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes, I actually, in a small way, I collect it. I kind of ran out of walls now, but I have bought two of Michael Carroll's paintings, including the first one we collaborated on, and I got one also from our trip to Antarctica. And that was a landscape that we saw from a place where we had to camp for two nights because of the height, the altitude of Erebus. You have to, you are taken by helicopter to a place where there are some Scott tents, and you camp for two nights to see if you can handle the altitude and get acclimated. And it was really miserable because, you feel kind of miserable, sleepy, and it was really cold, and there was really nothing much to do. And he did a sketch and took pictures and later a painting. It was called the Fang Glacier Camp. And I put it by my front door, and I say that, whatever today brings, I can handle it because I survived.
Because I've been there.
Yeah, I survived 2 days in Fang.
Oh, my goodness. I've had friends that have gone to Antarctica, and it is, from all kinds of ways, a very extreme environment. And, it's just amazing that people can go to such a hostile environment and survive it for any length of time, so. But I do want to go back a little bit to your Cassini days.
Right.
And I was at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory visiting another scientist there. And Linda Spilker, who's one of the principal scientists there, was of Cassini, was there, and we just got in this conversation about life in our solar system in general, and I happen to be a UFO skeptic. I know that there's some new videos and stuff like that, and I'm not someone that disbelieves that life doesn't happen elsewhere. In fact, I actually kind of believe that there's life all over the universe. That's my suspicion. But I asked Linda, just kind of point blank, I said, do you think that you're going to find life around the moons of Saturn or Jupiter? And she looked at me so convincingly and she said, absolutely. You know, it's, I, do you, it, you know, if you look at the way science has gone in astronomy, it went from like measuring, you know, the distances between stars, maybe, and then measuring distances to stars, and then with spectroscopy, measuring the chemical signatures of stars and the dynamics going on and the redshift and all of this. Would you say that science has now progressed to where really that the discovery of life elsewhere is one of the major parts of science today?
Certainly of space science, yes. In fact, is one of the major NASA goals is to find life elsewhere. And we think it's very likely that life evolved somewhere else. And I have an image of Titan on the screen. I was looking for it earlier, but you can see that has this very dense atmosphere. There's an image with the camera.
Yes.
And at the moment, in fact, I'm leading a team. We got a big project funded under the NASA Astrobiology Institute, and we're studying Titan from an astrobiological point of view, studying things like could this Titan has a lot of organic material in its atmosphere and surface, how this organic material have gotten down through the ice crust into the ocean. Could life develop under the conditions of this ocean? We have biologists who are reproducing the conditions in a chamber and with various microbes and things there to see how they evolve.
Sure.
And life is really so adaptable. It's quite extraordinary. And then more my part is, let's say that life evolved in this ocean, and then how these biosignatures that life form could come back up to the surface via cryovolcanism. Because if there is life in an ocean under an ice crust, but it never comes to the surface, then no sign of it ever comes to the surface, then we wouldn't know.
We wouldn't know.
Yeah, but and then what measurements we can make to try to detect this biosignature. So Titan is a really, really interesting place.
Yes.
It's also the
It's just so
only
interesting.
place.
Linda's so, I mean, this is very convincing assertion that that we're at, maybe not on the verge of finding life, but that we will eventually find it. So it's I was impressed by that, to say the least.
And here, Titan is also the only place in the solar system where you have liquids on the surface other than the Earth. So here is one of the mare or seas on Titan called Ligia Mare in a comparison with Lake Superior on Earth. So we have these liquid bodies of methane about 100 meters deep. As I said, we have a lot of organic material on the surface, such as methane and ethane and other hydrocarbons. Titan is a prime place to look for life, and Enceladus and Europa, are others. There are probably others. Triton, moon of Neptune. I really hope that we go back there. So there are a lot of really interesting places to explore, and this search for life, which we're also doing on Mars, it's really very exciting.
That is very exciting. A couple of questions have come up from the people visiting. Tracy Prell is asking, what is the current status of volcanism on Earth, and any comments or concern about the caldera in Yellowstone National Park?
Okay. The state of volcanism on Earth is, hasn't really changed, let's say in scales of lifetimes, change from the early Earth. But people often hear about volcanic eruptions in the news and they say, oh, there are a lot of volcanoes erupting. But in fact, there are usually, 20 to 30 volcanoes erupting every month. If you go to a site like the Smithsonian Institute, keeps that kind of record, and there is nothing unusual going on. And now and then we have a bigger one, but generally eruptions only get in the news if they actually if they are very photogenic or they kill people or they are particularly big.
Right.
But it doesn't mean that they're not happening
Right.
all the time. And the other part of the question was,
It was about the caldera in Yellowstone.
oh, Yellowstone,
Yeah, because that seems to be something that's a concern to a lot of people because it's so large.
Well, Yellowstone is very well monitored, and in fact, it's the largest caldera on Earth. It had very violent eruptions in the past. It doesn't mean that those will ever happen again. And the last eruption, which wasn't one of the worst ones, let's say, happened around 600,000 years ago. The magma chamber under Yellowstone is actually these days is largely solid. So, although an active volcano could always erupt again, it doesn't mean that the eruption is going to be, as people like to call it, a super eruption, necessarily. And we're going to, if it ever happens, we're going to have warning because it's very well monitored.
Yes.
Yes.
Peter Singh says, very informative presentation. How influential is volcanic activity in determining the composition and evolution of planetary and moon's atmospheres?
Oh, well, very important because volcanism is the material that brings material from the interior to the surface and the atmosphere. We can get a handle on what the composition of the planet is if it has an atmosphere from measurements of the gases in the atmosphere.
Excellent. Excellent. I guess we are getting towards the end of our talk. If there's other people that have questions, I've read about a lot of the recognitions that you have. You're a recipient of the Carl Sagan Medal, the NASA Service Medal. I'm probably paraphrasing that, but and the Latina women or Latina medal as well. So I probably butchered that, but those are amazing recognitions and awards, and you're certainly deserving of those. What is your what award or recognition are you most proud of?
Oh, well, that's hard to say because I've been very lucky to be recognized so much by my colleagues and the public. If I can show you another picture, it's related. This is a gorgeous picture of Saturn. And the rings and the with the sun, behind Saturn.
Oh, I love that image. I've seen
And
it.
yes, and this leads me to the Carl Sagan Medal. Maybe in some ways it's my favorite because I worked with Carl Sagan on Galileo. I mean, not directly, but he was on our team of Galileo scientists and and if you look at this picture very, very carefully, which you probably can't quite see it here, but I'll zoom in on it,
Okay.
and you are able to see that pale blue dot,
That's
which is the Earth. And And I love this quote from Carl Sagan, about that reminds us that, everything we are, everything we have ever, heard of in history, every person has lived in this little pale blue dot. And I think it really, this picture taken from so far away, it is a sort of inspiration to me, because it also reminds us that, we are one planet and, one species.
Yes. Rosalie, thank you so much for joining us on this program. What advice would you give to anyone that is interested in following a life of science like you?
I would say that everyone has to follow their passion. You have to decide what is it that you're really, really interested in, and follow that. And that's some advice that my father gave me. And even if it looks impractical or very difficult, but we can achieve amazing things if we really put our minds to it, and we're dedicated, and we put the effort into it, because nothing really comes without effort. So if you really have the passion, and if you're really dedicated, then you can do it.
Yes, I believe that too. Rosalie, thank you so much. Thanks for joining us on this program.
Thank you.
Thanks.